All right. Welcome, everyone. What day is today? Today is the... Today's the 27th of July. Richard would like everyone watching to know the roar of the crowd is not the crowd. It's just rain. There's really no crowd here. It's not applause for us. So, we are starting with the minutes. Did anyone, would anyone like to move the June 22nd minutes?
I'd like to motion to approve the minutes for June 22nd, 2015.
Second.
Corrections, changes, additions. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thanks, everyone. Do we have any adjustments to the agenda?
No, we do not.
I expect not, given given the room. Do we have any presentations?
No, we do not.
Richard, you're the only public here. Anything for us? Nah, okay. All right, look at that. We are on item number seven, and it is 6:03.
Nice. So in your packet, you have the superintendent's report. I would like to sincerely thank the Hadley Mothers Club and the PTO. The last day they provided, the PTO provided lunch for teachers in both buildings, and the Hadley's Mothers Club has offered to provide refreshments on opening day, which is really helpful, and I'm very grateful for their assistance and support, and those things go a long way in maintaining morale in buildings. Educator evaluation, I've spoken to you about this a couple of times, but I think that the committee and the district should be very proud of the fact that Hadley is in DESE's publication, promising examples from Massachusetts schools on building evaluator capacity, and I included a copy of DESE's publication in your packet that's posted on their website, and the artifacts that they refer to in their document are available digitally on the department's website.
That's awesome.
Yeah, I'm really, the credit there belongs squarely on the shoulders of the teachers who worked on this group. Mr. Udall was one of the administrators, but it was our teachers, our educator evaluation team, and they did a phenomenal job of putting this together and of working with Munson and learning from another district, and they're just so impressive.
Let's just call them out because it was on the DESE website. Jason Burns, April Camuso, Connie Douglas, Jack Corrigan, Annie McKenzie, Jeff Udall.
Yes, they did a great job, and there are others that have helped us in this work as well. Kathy Nigella, Deb Gill. So many people. So thanks to everybody. Student achievement data. I indicated last month or the month before that I had said to you I really would like to be in the habit of presenting you with student achievement data. The greatest challenge, I think, in resource allocation, particularly for school committees, and the school committee is really charged with ultimately the oversight, the passing of the budget and the oversight of that budget, and ensuring that resource allocation aligns with intended outcomes is really important, and it can be challenging when you're a school committee member because you're removed from the work of the classroom, which is why it's important for me to try to provide you with information. Last month you looked at DIVLS, which stands for Dynamic Indicators and Basic Early Literacy Skills. This is a standardized assessment that we give in K-1 and 2, and then beginning in grade 3, we give them maps and measures of academic progress. And what is really good news there is, I know some of the numbers are very small, you don't have any student identifying data, but you see, it describes it as low risk 89%, and what that means is that those students who are in that low risk category, that means that they have an 89% chance of being on grade level in reading at the end of grade 3. And that's also one of the reasons that you see that there's less growth between February and June. The assessment gets quite a bit more difficult. In February, the question is, what is the likelihood that you'll be on track for meeting grade 2 benchmarks in reading? And in June, we're trying to predict that you're going to be on track by the end of grade 3 is what DIVLS is saying. So it gets a lot more challenging, really, that you're going to meet your grade 3 benchmarks, so that you're going to accomplish your goals in grade 3. What you can see across grade 2 is I gave you both the mean and the median. Obviously, if those things are too far apart, that means you have some pretty wild outliers on your mean. So that's why I'll give you both, and you can see how close they are together. But you can see that there was some really nice positive change, some growth from the fall until the spring. I also wanted you to have this information because Hadley Elementary School started last year in a very, very small way in grade one in trying to deliver a more tiered instructional model, so really try to have smaller groups, have learning centers, target skills, and work with really small groups of children. And now we're hoping to expand that approach from grades K through three. There are, I believe, about 11 Hadley educators who are coming in August for a couple of days to work with the principal at Buckland Shelburne Elementary. They have a fully implemented and developed what's called a response to intervention model, an RTI model, and that's based on the Massachusetts tiered systems of support. You all probably, when you did your community survey, there was probably references to MTSS, this tiered system of support. So we're looking at expanding that. And these are data that once again demonstrate to us, even though overall things look really good, you see the scatter, right, of the importance of meeting the needs. In other words, green, red, yellow, right, that you see the importance, or what I'm trying to show to you is that we absolutely need instructional intervention models that help teachers meet a range of learners. When you look at the difference in scores, where some students are versus where other students are. So we
is
are...
Is the green bar going down here?
So
does that mean that that's just because, again, we're starting in the fall with where are they in towards grade two, and then in the spring, where are they in grades three?
Something else also happened. We had two students, so we have fewer students altogether. There are fewer students. We had two students leave the district, and so that also skewing things because our numbers are so small. Mm-hmm. But you're also correct. So it's a couple of things. One, that's we have fewer students, but also it is more challenging. If you even look at the differences in growth between September and February, well, you'll see students who may have a 50-point jump, and then from February to June, 15 points. Even very high-achieving students, where you see very high scores, the difference between the winter and the spring is much lower because the spring is far more difficult. The good news there, too, is seeing how many students are predicted to be on track for reading, and that's wonderful.
Yep.
Are there any other questions about the DIBELS data? So you can expect, I don't know if you'll see MAPS data in August. You can certainly expect a detailed analysis of MCAS coming out again in September as it did last year. And then you'll see various data sets throughout the year. And I have one high school teacher who's indicated to me right now that he's pretty excited about figuring out ways to show the school committee growth in his subject. A little more challenging at the high school because the tests I've shown you at the elementary are standardized, DIBELS and MAPS. So the tests at the high school are usually teacher-developed tests. It's a little more challenging to show comparable growth across classes sometimes. We can do it with finals and mid-years. But
we can do it with AP.
We can do it with AP, absolutely. That was actually, this teacher teaches an AP course too, so that absolutely we can do it with AP. We were just kind of scratching around to say where are some other places where we can show more standardized data. Not that other data isn't of value too. Right. Certainly, I would be interested in sharing with the school committee regular updates on percentage of students passing, all courses, so things like that. But not the same degree of standardization. The next thing in your packet is, these are the statements that are included in the surveys. And if there was any feedback that the school committee wanted to give, now this is not how it will go to parents. It would be in an actual survey document. But
tell us where did this come from, Connecticut?
Yes.
So this is kind of...
Yes.
Identical to the Connecticut study.
Yes. And in parentheses, so each recipient receives a different survey, but you can see several of these are the same. You're asking the different groups to rate the exact same statement, and it's strongly agree, agree, no opinion, disagree, or strongly disagree. And I didn't know if the committee felt as though there was anything that was not applicable or if there was anything that was missing.
This came directly from... All of these questions came from Connecticut. They're asking all these questions there.
They came from that document that I talked about a few months ago. So there were surveys in that document, yes, and they came exactly from that.
I had one suggestion.
And I'm sorry, I think I took one out, and it's, I can't remember, but truly, it just was not applicable to us. It was something that just...
What town in Connecticut are you from?
It was something that was not applicable. So I'm open to suggestions, because it felt, I will tell you, it feels crazy long to me. That concerned me. It felt really long. So I didn't know if school committee wanted to prioritize things. But Heather, your suggestion?
Small thing, but I think in framing each of these categories, by having them framed as issues, it almost already sets the tone up of, there are issues, we want your feedback. So just even calling it, you know, programming or equity or personnel.
I even wondered if the headers were going on there or if it was blind to the headers.
No, actually, those headers came right. That's how they were clustered, and that word is right in there. So you're correct in that.
I don't know.
Sometimes they present them as like, that's the section of those questions.
Yes, the following questions.
Right.
Yeah. The following statements pertain to personnel. The following statements pertain to, and just take out the word issues.
Yes.
Sure. That's a
good
idea.
But otherwise, I mean, if we're trying to be parallel to what the Connecticut group did, and we feel like, you know, this is something that we've said is of importance, and we want to really get the feedback from folks, then I wouldn't know what to prioritize in this if we were to start calling it down, honestly.
It will be a little bit, all of them will be a little bit shorter, because some are just, some of the questions are for just coaches, just parents, just students. I had one under equity issues, so that's the third page. Athletic programs for which I am responsible have been treated equitably with other sports. What the heck does that mean?
Oh, I know what that means.
If I could see how it would make sense if it was just to coaches.
Well, I think parents might, there certainly have been parents who have felt that one gender has been privileged over another.
But that's another for which I am involved.
So, and so this is also a place where, I'm sorry, thank you for pointing that out. They are probably worded slightly differently to get to that point. So it wouldn't be for which I'm responsible. Athletics, all sports that I play are treated equitably. So it's worded slightly differently. It's getting at the same thing. Is there any gender bias? Is there any sport bias? Are some actual sports for girls and boys treated differently than other sports? And it is worded differently. So the sports in which my student athlete plays are treated equitably or something.
And I would leave a lot of space, or maybe it's SurveyMonkey, and it's a growing space for the open-ended.
Okay. Yes.
And how's this being? How are people going to know to go take this?
Yes. And what? Yeah. What's the plan?
I'm open to suggestions for that too. And I had a very specific suggestion around getting feedback. So I'm thinking to distribute the surveys when the students are back in school, so at least I can say, and then we can push it out in terms of newsletters, and perhaps using coaches' meetings, using those parent athletic meetings. So we'll have a lot of opportunities in the fall to let people know. So how extensive? In other words, graduates, past athletes? We can certainly try. I mean, do you have a sense of...
I guess I would stay away from the historical, because what does it really matter at this point? It might be of interest, but is it really?
Right, I agree with that.
We have so much turnover in coaching staff over the years. We have so much.
I think we want to get this to a broad audience. I guess one concern I have of only doing it at the sports meetings is, what you don't get is a survey done by kids that have quit sports for some reason. And I think we'd want to know that. We'd want their thoughts and opinion as well.
Perhaps. Absolutely. I'm thinking the other advantage to having school in session is that we can make announcements, and then in physical education classes, any athlete, current athlete, past athlete. I may even ask if they might be amenable to giving the students an opportunity, since we know every single student goes through phys ed. So if the athletes wanted to take it then, or just be told about it. So certainly making sure that students who are no longer playing sports, I would agree, we want to hear from those students. Other suggestions or thoughts?
Is there any value to doing a test run? Having
you can do a small focus group just to get feedback, but sometimes they focus on the actual questions, which we'd want to make it sure they're more clarity rather than, you know, getting rid of questions, since we're trying to model this off of Connecticut.
Can we assume they were vetted in Connecticut? I don't know. Was it?
I would assume if that's
what they use. It's done by state organization,
yes.
Right?
So it's done by their MIAA equivalent, and then they've adopted that kind of NEASC model for sports,
right,
too,
right,
or athletic programs,
okay,
I should say.
Yeah, so I think we could say it's been vetted.
So are there any questions on here, though, that you'd want feedback from somebody who was never either a current,
right,
or past athlete?
That's the other issue.
I mean, I'm just wondering about if there is a larger perspective from other folks who haven't been involved in athletics about their perceptions. I don't know. I'm thinking that we are missing that side of the...
So getting at maybe why students don't participate?
Or the culture of sports in the school.
Yeah. I mean, because I'm seeing, you know, what single thing would you like to see changed about the program or towards the end? Mm-hmm. There may be people who were never involved in athletics for reasons that maybe they want to share. I don't know how you get at that.
Well, if the first question was, you know, have you ever participated in a sport? And it was yes, no, then no takes you to perhaps one or two open-ended, like questions
general,
in an open-ended,
yeah,
that says what has kept you from playing sports? And then you just quickly get that population.
Yeah.
And they don't have to answer the rest, because it's not applicable.
Right.
So have a yes, no option, and then kind of an opportunity to talk about why.
Yeah. Just build in logic up front so that you channel those people off and
yeah,
get at why.
I think that would be applicable for parents and students.
Yes.
Okay.
Agreed.
Those two populations.
And coaches, again, applying the same thing, that it's the current coaching staff.
Do you have past coaches who are still employed here?
Yeah.
That you would want their feedback? I mean, that's...
We do have...
Important. I think that's valuable.
Mm-hmm.
It's about culture. You know, we don't have a lot of sports, so we don't have a lot of coaches. So
okay,
it's a pretty small population. Mm-hmm. I guess in that sense, I could go back. I don't know about the rest of you, but getting... Yeah. For instance, we know Coach Campbell isn't coming back, but he mm-hmm. must have a very good perspective of sports in Hadley. Mm-hmm. I would wonder about asking Coach Camp.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
That's a good idea.
So historical with coaches, present, current with student athletes and parents.
I think so.
Okay.
And you're talking about grades 7 through 12?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Who do it at Hopkins? Any other feedback on that or suggestions? Okay. Mm-hmm. Post it on that.
Great.
We'll get that ready to go for the fall. I skipped this last month as well, so I need to make sure that I say it because there's no piece of paper in your packet. So our new special education program, I think it's important to point out that we currently have four students, or at the end of last year, we had four students enrolled full-time. And it is a very conservative estimate to say that if they were at an out-of-district private placement, that the tuition would be between $50,000 and $60,000. That's conservative, and that doesn't include tuition. So let me really underscore, mostly for the viewing public, that the primary reason we developed this program and the philosophical reason that the school committee and the district leadership recommended it is because we believe in the least restrictive environment, because we want children in Hadley to have options in their own public school district, and we want them a part of our community. And we want all of our students to be successful here. And it also happens because I'm saying this part because we saw that instructional support services in the FY16 budget had the most significant increase of any program, because the operating budget reflects that we started a new program. But the cost avoidance with just four students is very conservatively, again, between $200,000 and $240,000, and that's before factoring in transportation costs. So the cost avoidance is greater than the cost output for the program.
Because you think these students would be going out of district if we hadn't done this in this school year.
I do, and that is Pat Bell's assessment as well. She was very clear on that. I spoke with her about this, and they're absolutely, if this weren't an option, In some cases, we have students who have gone from out-of-district placements to the elementary school now. So we know for a fact that they would be in out-of-district placements. And we're happy they're here with us.
Great.
Another place that this is not in any way close to like a one-shot final, give us your feedback and we're finished. So I said to you, and I don't know if you recall, when Kevin Courtney came here many, many moons ago to talk about the end game is to develop a strategy document that isn't some sort of gazillion-page district improvement plan. And to get there, all that entry planning and reviewing the data and updating you on data monthly and trying to say, okay, what does this mean? What do we see and what does it mean? I also had said to you that in July that I'd be getting together with the administrators to try to start to make sense of what it looks like to go forward. So what I put in your packet was just what we started putting together on July 8th. And the administrative team felt really good about the work that they did. In terms of process, first stop with the school committee, any feedback that the school committee would have, we would then at tonight and again in August we can revisit this, and then in September my goal is to go to each faculty and to talk with the teachers in slightly smaller groups at their faculty meeting and other staff, invite other staff as well, and get their feedback. How does it sound? Does it make sense to them? And then bring it back again to the school committee for additional adjustments, feedback, and changes. And these things are never completely written in stone. They're always subject to input and change. What the document tries to do is lay out the vision, what the theory of action is, what we believe if we do something, then what will happen. The vision is taken directly from the school committee policy on your mission and goal statement and vision for the district. The theory of action tries to capture some of the data and the beliefs about what are the levers that we think if we push these levers, then we'll see an increase in student engagement and in student achievement. Each of the strategic objectives aligns with the standards for effective practice from the educator evaluation rubric. That's on purpose. It's not limited by them. It's trying to align it to standards for effective practice. The information highlighted in yellow, and I'm hoping that you guys have, you have. Mm-hmm. Those are just examples of artifacts or data that we might look at to determine whether or not we were making any progress. That's along the lines of brainstorming. Again, it's not meant to be limiting, it's meant to be a conversation starter. And I really want to point out under C3, our intent there was in no way to imply that the school committee's input was limited to a box. It was simply that if nothing else, we could really use help with that particular, how do we, in what ways do we want to engage parents, and how would we know that we were doing that effectively? Because as you know from last year, I've tried a few different things, some of which have been effective. I get out to a lot of events, but there are also many, many people who, for a whole host of very good reasons, can't be at all those events. And so that limits, I need additional ideas around that, what that should look like.
I think just thinking about, one thing I don't see on here that I think would fit in there is technology, and that we've talked about the use of technology through communicating to parents students' progress. So if we're using tools that are parent portals, things like that, I think that could fit under family and community engagement.
That's a great idea.
And we've made technology a priority through, whether that's also under instructional leadership as well. But that's definitely a strategic objective.
Thank you, Richard.
Temperature just went down like 10 degrees. Now.
Yeah, thank you. I think that's an excellent idea. And the seeing it perhaps as something that threads through all of the strategic, throughout the entire document, instead of limiting it to one space, like what role does technology play in supporting students' safety, health, and social emotional needs, and absolutely, in what role are we using technology to better engage families and community members? And in the learning of staff, we did a lot last year in terms of PD through the Tech Task Force for improving helping staff and providing professional development and technology for staff. So it's a really good idea.
Tell me your hoped-for timing. So review tonight, review again in August, review with the teachers in September, and then hopefully it becomes maybe at the September school committee meeting, this is our path for the year.
This is our path that we're really thinking, is this, are these meaty enough topics? Because what will come, what then comes, there will be more detailed work plans. If we say, okay, what real work do we want to do around this that would back this up? But is this weighty enough to keep us busy for 3 years? You know, are we looking at things that are weighty enough to keep us busy for a longer term? And also, this will drive our school improvement plans. So as part of that timeline, if the school committee were to say in September, yes, this feels good as a district strategy, the expectation is that in October, Jeff and Brian would be presenting school improvement strategies that are also aligned with this document, which you can see that's kind of already embedded in here. There's some specificity as to what you can expect to see at HES and at HA.
Well, the reason I ask is because I also see that this document could become really your performance evaluation tool in large part.
Yes.
And making sure that we have a tool in place so that we all know what you're being evaluated on as quickly as possible makes sense, since your evaluation period is really starting July 1.
Mm-hmm.
But then one thing that and we'll talk about, I don't think I've talked to you guys about this. One thing that I struggled with and that you and I talked about your performance eval was that it was very quantitative performance measures that we didn't yet have data about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so creating a tool, both for the district and for Annie, that is quantifiable performance measures, but quantifiable performance measures that we can have the data on during the time periods we need it is also important.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So that was one thing. The other thing is I wondered if we have talked about over the years doing a retreat to talk about our strategic plan, and I wonder if this is the time and if we want to try to do something in August or before the September school committee meeting where we spend some concentrated hours on this document and get into it.
I think it's time. I think it's we've talked about this for some time, and you know, as Annie's had a year to, you know, get her feet under her, I think it presents a good opportunity to reflect and hone in specifically on the next year.
Mm-hmm. I think it's a great suggestion.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So, half day?
Mm-hmm.
During the day?
Yeah.
Just because my brain works better?
Mm-hmm. Yes. September.
In early to mid-September?
Sure.
Yep.
All right. So how about if I do some doodle polling so that we can get Paul involved in this?
Yep.
Yep. Great.
Excellent.
Is that good?
Okay.
I'm not sure this fits, but I think it's part of the strategic objectives for the district, so I'm going to bring it up.
Yep.
There's nothing in here about finances and securing financial, what's the word? Stability isn't it, but it's also just, you know, looking forward into the future and making sure that the schools have the financial resources they need to be able to implement the plan. And I keep hearing about, you know, shortfalls with the town budget. And so I don't know where exactly that would go or if that's a separate thing, but I don't think we can ignore that aspect at this point.
I think it fits naturally with the management operations and financial planning.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Are we the district?
Absolutely. And some of what you'll see too, I mean, this is a great conversation. It'll be really good. I'm thrilled really that you want to spend some time talking about this and hashing it out. Some of the strategic priorities you see, you can very quickly see. So who's around the table? And I understood, too, when I invited school committee, you were invited to the day that we had with the administration. So you can very quickly see how each of the building leaders and the leader in all of our student services sees what this looks like in their work.
Right.
And it could be then that you say, you know, this actually is more of a school-based strategic priority, mm-hmm. and a district-based strategic priority should talk more about something else, right, that wouldn't be there.
Right.
So that would be great to kind of flesh it out. As I said, this is the very first, this is what we did on the 8th. So getting the summary. Great.
All right.
Okay, perfect.
Thanks, all. It does sound like fun.
Nice. All right. Perfect. Thank you so much. Athletic Self-Study Leadership Retreat and Personnel Report. Your personnel report has a great deal of information on it because it has all of your summer school appointments
yes.
on there.
We haven't filled any of the teaching slots.
So we have filled, this will be updated for you. So we have offered a position and it's been accepted. I believe it's been accepted, but we are very close to having all of our teaching slots, our 0.29 math slot filled, our physics position filled, and our paraprofessional at Hopkins Academy. So I'm refraining from completely announcing now because I haven't signed a PAF, but I believe, based on text that I received today, that we are all set, which is wonderful.
PAF.
A personnel action form, excuse me.
Oh.
Personnel action form.
Okay.
It's acronyms. So you will see those next month.
Okay.
From here.
Good.
All right. And that is it for me.
Because Chris is going to give us the news on the
I give all of the happy things to Chris.
Take it away.
And we have new happy things tonight. Skylights, right?
Financial stability.
We do, yes. Never a dull moment. So there's been a lot of discussion, I guess I should say, about the Hopkins Library and the insurance claim. We really ran into some problems with this, and it became quite an issue. And that is that we had the incident happen in April. Of course, then we had to get it cleaned up. We had some testing done on air quality, asbestos. And then we basically were hoping that the insurance company would have some kind of a dialogue with us. That dialogue, despite repeated efforts by us, just did not happen to the point of finally where the adjuster got fired. And then we finally got a dialogue. At that point in time, it was late June. So now we have an issue of bills in FY14 and 15, excuse me, and reimbursement coming after July 1st. What happens with that? Obviously, any bill we pay in FY14, that amount we would basically lose. So we basically went back and forth with the auditors, with Gail, with David, with the state at one point, trying to figure out what would be the best thing to do. It was determined that the best thing to do would be to file for approval from, first the selectmen had to approve, or select board, excuse me, had to approve it. Then it went to, David brought it to the state to get some kind of approval to allow us to basically cross fiscal years without any kind of a penalty, and that would allow the school department to save the money. David said that he had never seen that not get passed through, and now he has, because basically the state rejected our explanation. And so we are now going back to them.
Department of Revenue?
Yes. Mm-hmm. So now we're going back to them with our second attempt, basically, to say that, you know, there were issues that prevented us from moving forward on this quickly, such as the, you know, we got the cleaning company to come in, they vacuumed up all the moisture. That still didn't clear it all out. So then we spent the next 2 weeks with the doors closed from the library to the school, but the windows opened outside to air it out some more. Then after that was done, we had everything tested, and basically what we're saying is that all of these delays led to the fact that we're crossing fiscal years. We're hoping that will be something that allows them to bring it forward. So at this point, you know, it's really just one of those things. We were really in a no-win situation, so we're doing everything we can to try to make it to be a win situation. But at this point in time, I really don't know. We're talking about $10,000
But the library is repaired and will be open in the fall.
The library is not repaired because, of course, we had to wait for the insurance company to give us their version of the estimates to make sure that we were in line. Mm-hmm. Okay. Again, we got that. Oh, I would bet it was right at the end of June. The total is about $83,000. That is certainly enough to cover it. The total so far is that, because Jeff thinks now that the moisture that had gotten under the carpet is actually pulling the glue through the carpet, and now he's seeing stains all over the room. Yeah. So we may have to end up getting that pulled as well. Yeah. But it will be taken care of over the summer. So it was really the financial aspect of it that unfortunately just was out of our hands. The only way I actually got any kind of progress at all was to call. It's an outsourced adjuster, so it's not with the insurance company. And I called his supervisor and then was told that he was no longer working there, and they apologized. And unfortunately, you know, the apology really didn't help us. So
you said,
Department of Revenue had a huge number of early retirements as of June 30th. So there's like a lot of really senior staff that understood what was happening there. So if you still have troubles, let me know. I still know some people.
Okay. I sent David a second attempt explanation today. He will be contacting them with that, and then we can see, but I'll certainly let him know. So that's basically where we stand with the Hopkins Library. Did you have a question?
You said we'd be out 10,000.
That's correct.
Because that would be from the prior fiscal year?
That's right, year. Yeah. So essentially what would happen is that we would have to pay the money for the FY14 bills.
15.
I mean, sorry. either out of school choice or the local budget, which of course time is kind of running out for the local budget portion of it. And then the town would end up keeping that money. You know, the check would come in, the check would go to the town, who places it in their insurance revolving account, and after all the work was done, the leftover money would go to them. So, you know, I mean, basically the schools lose the money, the town does not, but nevertheless, it's certainly a hit to us without a doubt. So, and yeah, it's just about $10,000. There was an $8,000 bill and a $2,000 bill and then like a $300 or something for one of the tests.
And Chris, just so my understanding is correct on this, I want to make sure that I understood it correctly. The town has an insurance revolving account designed for this very purpose, which is, and the town isn't in any way, the town's all for this. It's not an issue
That's
with
correct.
The town. The town identifies, we have a fund just for this. And then when the insurance pays, the town's fund gets paid back through the insurance payments. Mm-hmm. But if the town is going to take more than $20,000 out of that, they need a vote from the select board, or town meeting. They need a vote from town meeting, not the select board. They need to vote at town meeting unless it's an emergency. And DOR, Department of Revenue, is taking the approach that this did not constitute an emergency. But I'm pretty confident that we can say absolutely that to not do anything means that we could have much worse problems.
It's a health and safety issue.
Yes, exactly.
That's basically why we're going with the had to keep the windows open for 2 weeks, then had to get testing, wait for the results, and go with that rather than the adjuster just would not return phone calls, emails, etc.
Well, no, if there's outgassing of glue coming up from the floor, that's an ongoing problem.
Sounds like mildew and mold is what's going on.
That's an ongoing problem.
You can certainly use that angle, yes.
Mm-hmm. How many vendors at this point do we owe payments to for their work?
Three.
Most
of it is to ARS Restoration. Mm-hmm. That was $8,000, and then the testing was another vendor, and mm-hmm. I forgot what the third one was. I just don't remember offhand.
Is it possible to negotiate anything where they can like re-invoice you in the new fiscal year so we could pay them in the new fiscal year?
Well,
is that not
the problem with that is that the town hall is certainly aware of our situation because we really had to go to the Department of Revenue as a team with them, and David had to bring it to the select board. So if all of a sudden that ARS invoice showed up with a July 1st date, they know.
Yeah.
And you know, really what that would do is then it becomes a really not so gray even area of legality in terms of, you know, breaking the rules there, so.
And also, I don't know.
Because the auditors have been involved.
That's
they
right.
know.
Everybody knows.
They.
Yeah. Otherwise, I have no issue with it.
Well, and I don't know if it would solve the problem. Not that that isn't a good idea. I don't know if it would solve the problem because at the end of the day, the place, we don't have any place to pay this out of. Except for school choice. We don't have an operating budget where we have this kind of money laying around. And the auditor, and correct me if I'm wrong, Chris, the auditor is really clear that we don't get a pay out of school choice and then the insurance, it's not supposed to be an in and out fund.
I did try that angle.
The town has a fund that is designed to do this.
And yes.
Right, yeah. It's just the amount that's throwing it off. Right.
Yeah.
And the timing.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
How long it's taking.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, every time I would email him, they would just not get responded to at all. When I would call him, I would leave voicemails. Twice I got phone calls back saying, I'll have that to you by Monday. I don't know which Monday he meant, because Mondays came and went, and you know, then I'd wait a couple weeks, call him again. I mean, it was really just, it was just ridiculous trying to get a hold of the guy. So we'll let you know at the next meeting what happens with this.
Do we have to approve anything tonight, or it's just on hold, but a possible?
It is on hold at this point, yeah. The next item we have is the capital plan and the warrant articles. This was basically just to see, we had the capital plan, and it was to see if you wanted to include the fields on the plan, because they were not included.
Well, you know, I was going to say, we took something off that I'm not sure we don't need to put back on. We took off the Hopkins parking lot, and there has been a fix of the worst part of it, but I think we're still going to need to do that parking lot in a couple of years, so I think we need to put that back on there.
And this is also, just so we're all clear, and Chris, can you remind me, this is due to the town August, I can't remember, but... So we have to, the other reason we're bringing it before you now is we will be turning this into the town in August. I can't remember the exact date, correct?
I don't remember it off.
But we do have to give this to them, so we want to make sure we're all on the same page. So Roby, you're suggesting that parking lot go back on because this is just kind of a temporary fix?
It doesn't have to be year one, year two, but I can't imagine in the 5 years you're not going to need to replace the parking lot.
Yeah, what they found when they were just trying to more or less patch the drain area, was that when it was originally done, there were miscellaneous materials used to hold up the drain. Snowplow pieces were one of them that were found. So it was going to keep sinking. So actually, they were really good. You know, they dug the whole thing out. They built it up properly.
It was like a time machine.
Yeah.
Nice.
And they repaved, there was a hump where the pipe was coming up,
so they brought
the pipe back down, and really repaved the worst areas. And, you know, the guy did say, gee, we'd like to fix the rest. And I said, well, you know, basically, there's no money to do that. And the next thing we're going to end up doing is the entire parking lot. So they were nice enough to fix, if you drive into the superintendent's office driveway, there were some pretty good-sized potholes right at the front of that, and they fixed that at no extra charge as well, so that was pretty good. As I said to Dee today, every time I pull in the driveway now, I smile because it's just so much nicer. And we can certainly add the parking lot back on there.
And then, of course, the fields. And I know that Roby can speak to more. I asked Roby if she would talk about building and grounds since Paul isn't with us. But the fields are such an expensive item. Is that something that we want to see on this?
So... Yeah, so we talked about the plan for the fields being to try and get some CPA money, to ask some of our booster clubs to sort of provide money and to sort of create a plan that used, you know, a combination of volunteer labor and hired labor.
Yep.
And so that is still our plan going forward, but I guess the question is whether we should have some money. There was some concern expressed at our meeting about maintenance for the fields.
Right.
So I don't know if how folks feel about that project, if they feel like the town should, if we should go before the town, at town meeting sometime in the next few years and ask for some money for that, or how you want to proceed.
Well, since this is a five-year capital plan that can change each year, I think we would be remiss if we didn't start to put it into the capital plan. It's okay. A project that's very important to many people in the community.
Okay.
So I think we ought to put it in and then just continually refine and update it.
Okay.
How, just as a starting place, how might you see, or, so there's a few options. I know the Building and Ground Subcommittee is looking to get together in the middle of August, and I don't think this is due until August, closer to around the 27th, maybe it's earlier. But are there any thoughts about how, even just as a starting point, do we want to put the entire amount in a particular year? Do you want to?
Well, Roby, you were going to try to kind of differentiate the total cost versus volunteer, and
we talked
about getting some professional help for that.
Annie got me a sheet to fill out.
So
that's what I'm working on, yes. And I have talked to, I have requested that we're on the agenda for the CPA committee in September.
Oh, good.
For their meeting, to go in and talk to them about our plan and whether they would be able to help us at all.
So between that worksheet,
mm-hmm.
and the September meeting,
yep.
well, preparing for the September
right.
meeting,
right.
we might have something to fill in the gaps
right.
for August,
right.
with the caveat that said to be refined.
Yes, but what we are working on is to develop the new land, not the entire redesign of the field. So what we're talking about is JV fields, soccer fields, and not reorienting the varsity baseball team field, and not removing the varsity softball field in, which is also part of the master plan.
Because we are talking about a phased approach.
Yes. Right.
So do you think, I mean, it would make sense to then, rather than put it all in 1 year, they'd phase it out over the years
right.
and divvy it out.
So yeah, right.
Once, if your sheet has that.
Right. Right. To look at the development of the new fields and then push out
the other
things where things are functional. But.
Yes, I would agree with that. I would make it as
yes.
longevity. And what year do you feel like we should place the starting year in terms of developing the fields?
1916
or 1617?
I don't know when the best time of year to do that is yet.
Okay. Right.
That's something someone has to tell me.
Oh, seasonally.
Because there are seasons,
it's a seasonal
so you have to.
Answer.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay. All right.
When grass grows, when grass okay. can be stepped on.
Okay. Right.
That kind
All right.
of stuff. Yeah.
Okay, so there is agreement, even if we don't have definite, we have definite figures in terms of what
right.
the entire plan will cost, but if we haven't completed the work of determining, we will not have determined what part, if any, CPA is willing to assist with. We won't have that information for the capital plan, so we can just take that it's a $1.2 million estimate for the total soup to nuts.
1.3, I believe.
1.3,
but, yeah,
okay.
we're talking about a couple of years old now for numbers,
okay.
but yeah.
So we would just kind of distribute those costs across five fiscal years, understanding that we're simply putting the town on notice that this is important to the community. It
mm-hmm.
is. It costs money. We don't have $1.3 million sitting in the school operating budget
right.
or anywhere else.
Right.
And so, Chris is chuckling. So we, at this point, it's just
right.
a kind of communicating and with additional details to come.
Yeah.
Right. And having been a member of the Capital Planning Committee, but I don't think an August document is the set, shouldn't
no.
be the set in stone document that it
right.
it can be refined and evolved as we have new information. I think it's a starting document to give
information
that committee
to the town.
A sense of
right.
what are we looking at for 16, 17, 18.
Right.
Okay. Perfect.
Does the 1.3 include the maintenance issue that you
no.
brought up?
No,
is
that's
strictly
seen
development.
As staffing, or is it seen as like infrastructure? Like
I think staffing. Staffing.
Well, but,
okay.
it, but part of it is how do you water the fields? Is
right.
it through the sprinkler system or the fire hose
it's idea. The cannon, the water cannon.
The water cannon, fire hose, water cannon. And so so that you fairly early on, you have to make a decision on
yeah.
which way are you going.
Yeah, that's pretty much been decided. We're not doing irrigation.
We're not doing a sprinkler system because of the long-term maintenance.
Exactly.
Yes.
Yes. Right. Yeah, you hope for good New England weather.
Right.
Yeah. But I think mostly staffing.
Okay.
Is the issue.
And Chris, the XXX in year four, is that because the column isn't big enough and it's a huge number, or you truly don't know what the number is?
We don't know what it is.
I like that answer better.
Yeah, Diane had asked for a quote from a vendor for that. To be honest, I mean, at this point, she's working in the facilities department, so I can just see if I can find her and see if she did get some kind of response
okay.
for it. We can update that as well.
And then you and Jeff Misch will figure out the parking lot thing and add it in there wherever you think it needs to go?
Yeah. I can see if you can get some kind of an estimate. I mean, we don't really want to go out and get estimates for it because we're nowhere near that.
Right.
But, you know, we can even just ask the guys that did this and say, okay, how much to do the whole lot?
When will they have snow plowing parts to use?
Yeah, that's something we'll have to go to other departments, I guess. Yeah, I don't know what was the deal there, but it was kind of interesting to be told that. So, unfortunately, you know, and really, I think, you know, that the barrier that was up around it,
yeah.
Jeff said that when you went and actually stood on that area, it literally bounced up and down. So, fortunately, we had that barrier there and nobody drove over it, because I think if a car went over it, it probably would have just fallen right
like
in.
A sinkhole.
Not the whole car, but
right.
whatever tire was on it would have gone in. So,
that's
it's really
just
great.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
I'm very grateful that barrier was there, too.
The other issue that I think we should talk about on the capital plan is having computers that need to be replaced so often on a capital plan as opposed to part of our operating budget. I mean, I think
you're saying that it should not be in?
Well, ideally, it would be in our operating budget, because are we going to ask the town to borrow for a Chromebook that's not going to be good before the loan's paid off? Do you know what I mean?
I totally know what you mean, but remember that last year we were instructed by the town to give a level services budget.
Yes. Okay.
And we specifically decided it would be wrong of us to include computer updates because that's not level services. But I agree with you. We've talked for years that we should be doing gradual, just like the town should be doing gradual updates. But we didn't build it into this year's budget because then the town asked us not to.
That's right. And really, it's almost inconceivable that we could expect, you know, this level service budget to continue without replacing things. I mean,
exactly.
You know, there does come a point in time where the useful life is just over.
Right.
So maybe that would be a discussion we could have with them when we get a little closer to budget season, that, you know, hey, we can do this, you know, semi-level service budget, but there are items that weren't in prior budgets that we're just going to need to replace. And,
well, it's not level services if you can't deliver your services because you don't
yes.
have...
Mm-hmm. Correct. Yeah, and you know? I remember we had the conversation of, like, is this level services? Is it expanding services? What's the definition? Mm-hmm. So...
Yeah.
And, you know, one could make an argument that that is level service. I mean, we had working computers.
That would be my argument.
Right.
Yeah.
So perhaps as part of when the Buildings and Grounds Subcommittee gets together, we can just be clearer on when we submit this to the town, how we frame whether they're on or they're off, meaning the computers, to say, which is where we started last year,
right.
we don't
right.
have them on here because we believe they should be a part of the operating
That's
budget,
right. Right.
but if we find ourselves in the same position we were last year, they'll
right.
reassert themselves.
Yeah, I think that's, yeah. Right. I just want people to know that we understand
yes.
where they should be.
Exactly.
Right, and things right. like $1.3 million fields are things that are far belong in a
yes.
capital plan.
Exactly.
great.
Next, we have the revolving accounts. Did you get the report?
Yes, I sent it separately in a separate email to them.
Yep.
All right, so this is basically the year-end version of that. The nice one to look at, of course, is the lunch account that's back in the positive. There will also be the June reimbursements from the state as well, so we'll have a few thousand dollars more going into the account. So that'll certainly start it off at a little better balance than we started off last year with the $95 that we had in it. So
it's above zero. It's a positive balance.
It's way above $8,000 in parentheses. And this is sincere. Chris and I talked about this. Diane's act deserves... Diane, I hope you're watching this. We are live, right?
No.
Oh, we're not live. At some point, Diane, I hope you're watching this. Chris and I want to say, phenomenal job.
I did
chasing
have
down
that.
Those lunch accounts. That really...
It was down to about $70.
Wow.
And, you know, we were talking at the $1,100 to $1,200 area throughout the year, so... She really chased it down. Last I spoke with her, which was, it was after June 30th, when I gave her a review, and we discussed that, and she said that she was going to make one more effort to, chase down the remaining $70, and I told her, you know, that's good, and then after that, it's probably time to just walk away and say, okay, you know, I got 99% of it, but... Yeah, that was outstanding. So
she got it all.
That was certainly
very good job. So we're going to start strong with $95 going into FY16.
Well, we'll probably have about 4,000, I would say.
Wow.
Because we have the reimbursement coming in as well. Good. Still, that doesn't come in until July. So
excellent.
It'll be nice, you know, just to start with something certainly. Any other questions on those? The grant report, it's kind of a boring report, really. It's just a year-end grant report that shows that we spent all the money, with the exception of the circuit breaker money. You can see we have a pretty good-sized balance going over into next year, which is nice because that money was not, we weren't expecting to carry that much over.
Yeah.
Now, it may decrease slightly, I'm thinking by about $10,000, because what I did at the, maybe about the 20th of June, was I transferred a large amount of expenses that we had charged to Circuit Breaker over to the local budget. And basically that freed up the money in Circuit Breaker to carry forward. And then I would just wait and see where we ended up with. And it looks like we're about $10,000 in the hole. So we'll just transfer that back over and we'll end up with zero balance at the end of the year. So it is nice to have this because, you know, again, the volatility of that special ed area is something that we always have to keep an eye on. And so at least to have a little bit in there just to say, okay, well, this was extra than what we expected. That will certainly be a big help going into this year. Other than that, though, all the grants are used up and gone. So. And...
Lunch prices.
Lunch prices. Yes, I have some notes on that. Let's see, so the discussion was, you know, whether or not we wanted to raise the price by a nickel. We were right on that border of we don't really have to raise it this year, but next year's increase would be bigger. Mm-hmm. I did contact the other districts that our company does, and they had a couple of things that their districts do when they're losing money, which, again, a good portion of them are. One is to raise prices, which, you know, that's kind of the obvious, but again, you can't just raise prices to the point of where you're breaking even again because nobody would buy the lunch. So the other one they said was to outsource. Even that's not really an ideal situation because the district would still be on the hook if the vendor lost money on it. Usually they'd have some kind of a break-even clause in the contract, and whatever they were in the negative, we would then have to pay them at the end of the year. So either way you look at it, you know, it's just one of those situations that it's just something we're going to have to keep an eye on, you know. Diane did mention, and I wish I had the price that she's actually charging for them. I just don't. The adult meal price, she said, we're way lower than everyone else as far as that goes. And she said maybe we should raise the price on that. I can certainly get that for you as well. But, I mean, let's see, adult meals, we served about 500. So we're not talking a huge windfall. If we
so we're talking like $10 a meal then?
Yeah, plus tip,
I guess. Deprive me of my spinach.
So that's basically where we are. It looks like from the number of lunches that they served this year, we'd make a little over $2,300 extra by increasing the lunch a nickel across the board. As you can see, obviously, from the report that we just looked at for the revolving account, that's not enough to bring it back into the positive anyway.
I'm sorry, can you remind me where it is now and the last time we increased it?
It's at 275 now. We increased it last year from 270.
Last year this time?
Yes. Yeah.
And you're saying we could go up to 280? What's the minimum?
Excuse me?
We brought it up.
$3 was the max we could go up.
Three was the max, but we brought it up to 275 because we had to.
That's correct.
275 is
yeah.
the minimum.
Yeah.
Yeah. Correct. If we were any lower, we'd have
and
to.
And so we're right there now. Next year we'll have to increase it, obviously, if we don't now. We may still have to this year. We'd have to do they send you a sheet with all the calculations, and then we have to see if we're actually averaging below or not.
And when would you have that?
Next year's sheet?
Yeah.
It's probably comes in June.
No. For this year,
this year we've already done it, and we're right at that, where we don't have to increase the price in terms of the state saying it. We're right at the very bottom of, their range. But next year, obviously, we know we're going to have to increase it. It may be a bigger increase than a nickel next year. That's why we didn't know if it's better to kind of do it a nickel a year versus nothing this year and then a dime next year. The only benefit to doing it a nickel is, just that you'd see the revenue from it this year instead of waiting 2 years. But again, it's just one of those difficult things.
Right.
Because you can't charge what they're actually worth because they just won't buy it.
But in terms of the options you're laying out to consider, one is, does it make more sense to have a smaller change or wait, no change, and then have a significantly larger increase, double the change.
Did you have any info on the milk sales? If that's different than the lunch sales? Because I think you can buy them separately.
You can buy them separately. I don't have the number of milks sold. I can certainly ask Diane for that as well.
I was just wondering if I'm remembering this right, lunch price includes a milk, but if you don't get lunch and just get milk, could we increase the milk price basically by 5 cents and say...
Oh, I see what you're saying.
So if you don't get lunch, though, we still are able to recoup the 5 cents.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know.
Sure, yeah.
If that helps.
Probably helps less, because I imagine we sell more lunches than we sell individual milks, but I have no idea if that's true.
But the price, if you increase the price of the lunch,
right?
But if you're saying that that's really reflected on the price of the milk too, so they both go up essentially.
Yeah, and I don't really know when the price of milk has been increased here.
We didn't increase it last year.
So basically, it's one of those things, obviously prices go up.
Right.
It would really make sense if you're going to raise the lunch price to increase the milk as well. So I can talk with Diane, see what kind of milk sales she has, and if there's any kind of guidelines as far as pricing goes for that as well. And I can certainly let you know.
I think it's 40 cents right now, if I'm remembering right. To buy it separately.
Okay.
When does school start?
Teachers, August 27th, students, 9-1. The following Monday from that, August 27th is a Thursday, the students come in the next Monday. That's 31st, thank you.
And the school committee meets on the 24th, so I was wondering if can we delay this to get information on milk, or do we want to make a decision now?
We should probably make a decision, because I would think that point of service folks need to know.
I was just going to say, Diane would need to know
before,
as much as possible, as early as possible. If we're looking at the milk, that can be one of those last-minute things, but I think she said even about sending letters home to parents, she needs to get all this information out. So
if you increased it by a dime, does that help at all?
What? Well, then you'd be looking
at
just under $5,000. let's put it this way, you're looking at just under $5,000 with the current number of lunches served. Now, if that sways
people not to buy lunch,
then you're looking at less. It's really just impossible to know what the mindset is of.
Yeah, I have no clue.
No, I mean, nobody would, you know, it's just, sometimes people just say, geez, I can, you know, at this point, all right, that's too much, you know.
I don't know what the tipping point is.
I propose we just increase the lunch by 5 cents at this point.
And the milk?
No, both? Just the lunch.
So what you're proposing is that we would increase it this year and probably the next year?
Well, next year we may have to catch
that
up.
That we're basically going to do small increase. Try to keep the increases small, but do them annually. I don't know. There's no good answer.
There really
there
just
isn't a good answer other than having it federally funded.
So Heather's suggesting go up lunch prices by a nickel and exploring milk. We could do that in August if we wanted, right?
Yes.
Do we still sell ice cream? No.
Those little only on Fridays, I think.
Only on Fridays.
I don't know about the high school. Maybe every day in high school?
I go looking for it every day. I think I usually find it. I go looking. There's a
spinach and ice cream in there.
It's a healthy lunch.
Yeah.
I do my part for the lunch program.
I know you can buy Doritos.
You can buy Doritos every day?
Probably so.
Oh, jack the price on that.
Doritos out of Georgia Foods.
Don't have
a really good plan.
A motion to increase lunch by 5 cents, but I only have a motion.
I don't even know if we have a motion.
I move motion to increase the lunch price by 5 cents, so up it to $2.80 for this coming school year.
Well, to the point about Doritos and ice cream, does that
make sense? Could you come back in August with milk, snack, frozen, what's it called?
Frozen treats.
Frozen treats.
What? I would see that on the bill.
So we could, so that we have the advance information out to parents, we could vote the nickel on lunch prices, see in August if the snack prices need to go up in lieu of the lunch prices, but at least give them the bad news instead and take it back. Or
maybe not
or
have
we need,
as
or
much
maybe
of an increase next
both.
Year, if you can find some alternative.
I kind of feel like if we're going to increase prices on healthy lunch, we have to increase it for snack and ice cream stuff. Like the cost of those things are going up too. Shipping costs more, gas for trucking costs more. And if we haven't touched it, then you know that it's still cheap. And it's gonna be the thing that people are gonna gravitate towards because
it's cheap.
That's not sending the right signal.
So do you want to say we're increasing it now, or do you want to get more information on what?
I think it's important to say we're going to increase it now.
Everything. 5 cents.
I think we need to know the price that they're charging now for Doritos and what else is offered before we
decide
that. So I think we should go ahead with the, if we're going to increase the price on a school lunch, we should do that tonight. And then in August, we can have the information about the other things.
Sure. I mean, I don't even know if they charge different prices for different items.
Yeah. I think we should say that it's likely.
I was going to say, the compromise is that we make the motion, say, 5 cents for lunches now, with the expectation that we will
likely increase all the other.
I would prefer to raise the price on Doritos over the milk.
Right.
Yes,
exactly.
Agreed.
Yeah.
Okay,
so we have a motion.
Now we have a motion, I believe. Do we have a second?
Sure.
Okay. And so the motion is, I guess,
tortured. Increase lunch by 5 cents and FY16 for a total price of $2.80.
Mm-hmm. And explore. And I think we want in the motion and explore the snack
increase
prices small. And address increasing that. And we'll get back to that in August.
Sounds good.
Okay. Yep. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank
woo!
You.
Okay.
That's all I have.
Do we have generators?
No.
Oh, God, don't talk about generators.
Yes, please stop. We had a second walkthrough today.
Check my head on camera.
As I said when I walked back into the office, we had people request an additional walkthrough, and the people that requested it didn't come. So we had another one today. One vendor showed up that wasn't at the first one and walked through. The bid opening is next Thursday. So, I mean, I do anticipate. We sent out about 15 packages, so you know, we should get
out.
That's
not all bad news.
No, no. I mean, the question is really where the pricing is going to come in.
Right.
You know, that's
mm-hmm.
the big issue. So
yeah.
We'll see what happens.
Okay. Are you able to join us in August?
For?
I didn't know if you were on vacation. For our next meeting.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I was on vacation last week. So.
Oh. Chris, do you have a good vacation?
We were shopping for schools for my daughter.
Oh,
yes.
You had an expensive vacation.
It's quite, well, future expenses, absolutely.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, school committee reports. Roby.
Yes, I think I already gave you the building and grounds subcommittee update. The CES update is that we adopted the fiscal year 16 budget, and the board has decided that they would like to discuss issues that are of concern to area school committees with the idea of lobbying legislators. And we had our first discussion, which was about declining enrollment and school choice. So it's pretty interesting. I think they're hoping to reinstitute legislator breakfasts, which is something they used to do several years ago.
Right.
Mm-hmm. That's great.
I suspect we will also be talking about testing in the fall.
I would imagine so.
Yeah.
And, right. And if
we're
the
down
rumor
to
about regionalization is true, will be another topic.
Oh, yeah, and it is Franklin County and Hampshire County, so there will be a lively discussion about regionalization.
I'm sure so.
Yes. So, yeah, people are not, declining enrollment is a problem that everybody has, and some people feel that neighboring school districts are predatory, consider school choice a necessary evil. Thinks that legislators in eastern Massachusetts don't understand that school choice and charter schools operate differently in a rural setting than they do in an inner city.
Mm-hmm. That's excellent. That's going to be one of the focus areas. I think, just personally speaking, I think that's fantastic that then school committee members can come together and have a greater, probably, influence, one would hope.
Yeah, it wasn't just venting. I mean, there was some venting about Roe and and things like that. But it was really constructive about what's reasonable to present to legislators.
That's great. Good. That's great.
Heather.
Unit D, which is the education support personnel group. We've been meeting. We had a meeting with them. We've got meetings on the calendar. In negotiating a contract with them, and I would say I know our ambitions are to have this moving ahead in late August, early September, but that's right now. It is, we had a meeting scheduled for tomorrow, but we are not meeting, so we'll need to make up something there, but yep. Otherwise we've got everything scheduled and planned out.
Linda, superintendent evaluation. Thank you, everyone, for your help in the superintendent evaluation. Annie and I went over it last week. Summary was Annie did a great job in her first year. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you, everybody.
The rules of the evaluation are that we must vote an overall rating in public mm-hmm. session. The overall rating, the average overall rating in her performance review was proficient. So I would ask for a motion of overall rating of proficient for the first year of Annie's tenure with us for her performance eval. That will then go to submit to DESE by law.
Yep.
With all of the other evaluations in the district.
Mm-hmm. So moved.
Oh, did you just make that motion? It was not very well stated on my part.
I didn't
part.
Want to try and rephrase it,
yes.
So I just said
thank
so
you.
Moved. It's a wonderful phrase.
Thank you.
I'll second that.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
And the only, I do think that doing the retreat and thinking about the strategic plan and moving one of our tasks being to move that strategic plan into Annie's
evaluation for next year, really thinking through the quantitative measures. As you note, one of the performance measures that Annie had this year was increase improvement in MCAS scores. Well, you can't evaluate that when in a July 1st, June 30th performance when MCAS scores come out in September. So we need to think that through to make sure that the quantitative measures are fair and reasonable. So the other thing is that the town is engaging in a SWOT analysis, strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. We could do that this evening if we were so inclined, or we could say that is part of our half-day retreat agenda.
A SWOT analysis of what?
The town.
Of the town?
Of the town or no, the schools.
No.
And we're supposed to do the town?
It's a town, so each department is helping to inform the town's budget process. So I attended a department head meeting of the town, and at that meeting they reviewed the new budget process. So we're hoping to start it even earlier, and also looking to get input from every department about the town. So,
and can they wait until the timing of our proposed retreat?
I think so. I think that certainly, I mean, I can check into that.
I guess another option is, to be honest, I don't want to do it tonight.
No, I don't feel prepared to do it tonight if it's about the whole town. We could talk about school stuff.
So we could have it as a homework assignment or as a retreat assignment.
I think it makes sense as a retreat assignment if we're reflective about our own process and metrics. We can talk about the ways in which the town supports are, you know, as helpful and harmful as this SWOT analysis might suggest.
And I'll verify before the retreat. I'll ask specifically in an email to David and say, how are you planning? What information will be most helpful from us? What is the perspective you want us to take?
That'd be great.
Who all is completing these? Any department?
Every single department is my understanding in the town, so.
Were there instructions that accompany this thing? Or guidance?
Just what's on there.
Just the email, and this was the attachment. But I'll make sure that I didn't miss anything. So I'll, in fairness to the town, there could be something that was sent along, or maybe it didn't come to me for some reason. So I'll get some additional information.
Okay. And do we know who's compiling it? Who's doing the analysis and the integration?
I don't, but I can find that.
One thing I forgot to tell you to make next year's performance evaluation easier, I will be keeping a notebook of all of the different...
It's a pretty notebook.
Thank you.
You're like Carol Merrill.
I know, of all the different standards and objectives, et cetera, that Annie will help me fill throughout the course of the year so that then we have a hard copy. I know you guys all work digitally, and I'm the only hard copy holdout, but it seems like a notebook, although old-fashioned, will be helpful.
I also, you may have noticed, I've done this before on our agendas and certainly on emails that I've sent to you, but I've also tried to italicize if there's something in the packet that pertains directly to a standard. Mm-hmm. I've indicated that on the agenda.
Which will help me fill my notebook.
I think that's very helpful.
Smart.
So, have we done everything?
We have.
So we have to schedule a retreat.
Right.
I will do a doodle poll after I've talked to Paul. Our hope is early, mid-September. You will talk to David and see if the SWOT analysis works in that regard, in that time frame. You're going to, Roby, do a little bit more on this fields worksheet, and we'll add that to the capital plan. We will continue on with D.
Mm-hmm.
Chris is going to give us a parking lot cost and snack prices.
And Doritos and treats.
Yeah, Doritos and treats. And
bring Doritos if we're going to talk about it.
I forget what they call the ice cream snacks. I used to work in the frozen.
I think they call it Miss McKenzie's Hotspot.
There was a word for it.
There is a word for them.
Yeah. The Ding Dong Truck?
No, what they're called. There's a special little term for them in food service.
Yeah, apparently, yes. Because they used to tell me to go fill them, and I didn't know what they were talking about.
And August 24th is our next meeting? I thought it was the...
I did too. I'm not going to be here. I thought it was the following.
Oh, August 24th.
It's August 24th.
I will not be here.
All right. Who, will everyone else be here?
Actually, hang on a second. It's possible I'm...
I will be.
I'm on business travel.
Uh-oh.
I am.
Why don't we move to the 31st then?
That'll be excellent if we
can.
Do
we?
That's the first day of school.
Sure, we can.
It is the first day of school.
It's the first day of school, then I'm pretty sure I'll be here.
Yes.
Good.
Check
too.
The calendar. I'm pretty sure I'll be here. So we'll be changing
okay.
that to
is that okay with you, Linda?
31st.
Yep.
You're good.
All right. Chris, August 31st? Okay. Richard, August 31st instead of August 24th? Okay.
And the time is what?
Well, I think we'll
do
5:30, and okay. if we need to do executive session, we'll do it ahead of time so that, no? Yes?
Nope.
That sounds great.
Fine.
Okay. All right. Motion. I'll take that motion to adjourn.
Motion to adjourn.
Moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
I'm going to say that you guys seconded each other.
We did.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you.